We've got a special task force of senators who are going through the budget line item by line item, and that process is being led by Senator Craig Blair, who's a Republican from Berkeley County. He joins me on the phone now from the State House in Charleston. Senator, good morning to you.
Good morning, Mike. Thanks for having me on. And hey, that was a great intro on how you explained things was going on. Delegate Molly, I believe, will do anything to make it so that we don't have a budget in September, let alone July the 1st.
Well, and I think Senator, I think his position is, you know, I know Tim, is he thinks that's going to provide some political clout for the Democrats in the general election come November. But, I mean, he was Speaker of the House. The shortest tenured speaker was a year and a half. He got thrown out because people were sick and tired of that kind of leadership style in our legislature. And he led the charge. It was defeated. Now Plan B is not going to be very it's going to be a tough job, isn't it?
It's going to be a tough job, and we have to make tough choices. What you were talking about on going line by line in the budget, that's in place regardless. I went to the leadership. And by the way, I was in the House of Delegates for 4 terms, 8 years, and I'm a big believer in term limits, so it was either time to move out, move up, or move over. I actually got moved out, and now I'm in the Senate 2 years after that. But we need to be going through this budget, and so a lot of the stuff we can't get done this year. We're up against the clock. It's impossible to do it. But I said to my leadership, I said, hey, look, give me a committee. We can go in here and look at different things. Look, Special Olympics is an example. $50,000 a year coming out of the budget. I made one phone call, and I'm quite confident that I've got a sponsor from every year forward where we're not using tax dollars, but the private sector to be able to match up and be the sponsor of the Special Olympics. Fairs and festivals. Everybody's always worried about the fairs and festivals, and one of the reasons that's tied into the budget is because of the fact that you can actually exercise influence over your members. That's what's been done in the past. If you don't vote this way or that way, we'll cut your budget or cut them out of the budget. That's not the way it's done now, but better yet, that it's 1.6 million or 2.4 of on the fairs and festivals. Why aren't we getting somebody that'll privately sponsor of that, and it's a win-win scenario?
Well, there's a lot of line items there, but at the end of the day, that all could have been avoided had the House compromised and passed that 45-cent tax, right?
It could have been avoided for this year, but
right.
In my heart, it has no business being in the budget to start with. It's making, I don't know the right word for it, dependent
right.
On government. And we need to get away from this dependence on government, whether it be agencies or the osteopathic school is a prime example of to where it's a shining star in the state of West Virginia, but how much better could they do if they were not under the umbrella of West Virginia's government? Heck, 27 out of the 33 of them in the country are for not-for-profits and are prospering.
And doing well. Hey, Senator, let me ask you, Senator Carmichael said yesterday something that really tweaked me, and I've been listening and hearing this a little bit and more, that your committee may consider the privatization of some of our colleges and universities, and one of those may be the West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine in Lewisburg. Tell me your thought process about that.
Well, what happened was I was down there about a year ago, and we're going through, taking a look at it, and I was so impressed. And I've got to looking at the new buildings, and I just asked the magic question, and I said, how much would you have paid for this if you didn't have to pay prevailing wage? And they told me, it seemed like it was like $2 million less. And then they got to talking about, I said, why do you even want to be under the umbrella of West Virginia? And you know, we talked a little bit back and forth on this, but let's go to why I'm choosing osteopathic school to at least float this out here right now. They don't have any bonding. They don't have any debt right now. So they're the, quote, low-hanging fruit that we could look at, and if they chose to, we're not, the legislature's not dictating them, you're getting out, but we're giving them an opportunity. If they think that they could actually do better, expand, and prosper, and have a create a greater student base, then why would we not want to do this? Well, an absolutely shining star in West Virginia.
And as you mentioned, that's a debt-free campus, but it still costs the state, what, about $6.8, $7 million a year in state support. Do you think they could make that up if they were a private school?
Well, I'm quite certain that they can make that up. It's a private school. They got 800 students down there, and, you know, 200 of them come in every year. And the fact of the matter is that it looks like, from the, what I've understood, is they have a backlog of students of about 1,700. And keep in mind that what I'm talking about here is a prototype. I'm not talking about any of the other schools
right
at this point in time. I'm talking about looking at one that is capable of doing if they chose to.
Hey, Senator, can you hold with me? Can you hold with me through the break?
Sure.
Okay, hold with me through the break. Just a couple minutes, folks. We're talking to State Senator Craig Blair, who's leading a task force to look at the budget items and where we can reduce our spending, our overall spending. When we come back, we're going to talk more about this issue as it relates to college and universities in the state. Stick with us. It's 9:30. It's time for a Metro News break to find out what's happening at this hour all across the great state of West Virginia.
You're listening to the Mike Queen Show on the HAR News Network.
Hey folks, welcome back. We're talking about the fallout from the House Democrats' failure to compromise on the budget plan presented by the governor and the state Senate. The governor and the state Senate had a compromise bill prepared. It goes over to the House of Delegates, and Delegate Tim Miley, who is the minority leader, said absolutely not. They weren't not in support of all the additional budget reductions, the line item cost reductions. They wanted more and higher taxes, so they refused and rejected the proposal, the compromise proposal that was reached between Governor Earl Ray Tomlin, who's a Democrat, and the Republican-led state Senate. At the end of the day, of the 36 Democrats in the House of Delegates, all but one, and that's Tim Miley's counterpart in Harrison County, Delegate Patsy Trikos. Patsy Trikos was the only delegate to stand up and say, this is a compromise. We don't like raising taxes anymore when we have to. This is a compromise. It gets us a budget. It protects funding for PEIA. It protects funding for the Promise Scholarship Program. And it buys the legislature more time to work on the next year's budget. And Miley and his group just thumbed their nose up at it. If it wasn't political, every Democrat but one in the House of Delegates wouldn't have voted against it. So now what do we do? Now we're going into Plan B. State Senator Craig Blair from Berkeley County, a Republican, is leading a task force of legislators to go back through the budget again and line item by line item talk about cuts that are going to have to be made, additional cuts that need to be made, because that $78 million in that tax increase for the 45-cent tobacco tax isn't going to be there. So they got to cut out more, and they're certainly willing to do that. One of the issues I thought was interesting was State Senator Mitch Carmichael, who's the majority leader in the state Senate, suggested that maybe we look at privatizing some of our schools. So we're talking a little bit with Senator Blair about that. Senator Blair, you talked about the great financial status that the osteopathic school is in Lewisburg, and perhaps using it as a prototype if they would be interested in going to a private status. Is that fair? Am I that a fair description of what your thought process is?
Absolutely, and let me make it clear that I haven't had any discussions with the chancellor, the leadership, or whatever of the school. It is just looking at the fact that how we can basically get them out of the budget and set them free from the bureaucratic red tape that everybody, whether you're in business or whether you're not, has to deal with the state government. And you know, that's one of the things that we're trying to do right now is to eliminate it. I'm chairman of the government org over here, and we've eliminated out 9% of the rules. We're the most overregulated state in the union, and we got rid of 9% of the rules, and I can't wait to get at more of them. There's a DEP rules bundle that actually failed, and we're hoping that gets put on the call somewhere along the line. That'll move us up to 12% if we could get that rules bundle gone, and it sends a message out to the private sector as well.
Well, we have a lot of small colleges here in and universities here in West Virginia. Let me ask you a little bit, how would you envision, as chairman of government org and trying to talk through this process, you're not advocating that the osteopathic school goes private this year. You're saying let's take a process and see what the cost benefits versus the pros and cons of going private would be. So are you anticipating some kind of oversight with the legislature and the osteopathic school and the governor's office? How would that work from here?
You know, we'd have to work together. First of all, we're floating this idea out right now. The osteopathic school and the leadership and the board of directors and all for that would actually have to say, hey, we'd like to explore this idea as well. And when they do that, then that's where they come back to the legislature, and we work together to be able to unwind of how we're intertwined there together and make it so then, because, you know, the students that are going there at this point in time are under paying a certain tuition, and they're expecting that for X period of time. So you got to be able to, it's not something that you can just write a bill for and walk away. It takes a little bit of time to do it. But I actually believe that if the O school got ready and said, hey, we're interested in this, that we could actually have everything in place and done by June 30th of 2017. And that gets them out of the next budget.
I tell you, I'm intrigued by the proposal. That's why I wanted to ask you a little bit about it. And I appreciate you taking time to come on the show. I'm intrigued by that proposal. I'm a former member of the Board of Regents that oversaw the governance of all of our public schools, our public college universities, for a number of years. And obviously, being a member of the legislature in the past, being on the Education Committee, I think it's got a lot of interest. And I appreciate you trying to think outside the box. But let me ask you one more question. With that failure of the House Democrats to pass the budget, and they made it very clear they want higher taxes, they want more taxes, they don't want any more cuts. It looks like now if you're going to start cutting, you're going to get those Republicans that voted against it to join you, because that's what they want, right? They want a smaller government.
And so do I. I've never voted for a tax increase that I can remember the whole time I've been in the legislature to now. And it was a 45-cent tobacco tax. It had the least impact there is out there. And by the way, it's a luxury tax. You don't have to smoke unless you want to. And so it was one of the, and it's cost, also border counties, the amount of revenue that comes in across those counties as well. You take it up to a dollar. By the way, Molly and them over there, they kept saying that they wanted a dollar, but there was no amendment to it to do it. I'm telling you right now, if I'd have been over there in the House of Delegates, I would have made the amendment just to put them on the board on whether they were going to vote for it or not. Now here we are today. If I actually was in the House of Delegates, what I would do is I would have some find one person that voted against it and have a reconsideration of the vote and squeeze them. And I actually put it on to an amendment stage again and put that dollar on there and find out whether the money was where their mouth is.
That's why Tim Miley's no longer the Speaker of the House. You know, hey, State Senator Craig Blair, thank you very much for joining us. Good luck and thanks for what you're doing.
You're welcome. Thank you.